Word. Please read along with me from Matthew chapter 8, chapter 28, verses 16 to 20. Now the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain to which Jesus had directed them. And when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and said to them, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. And behold, I am with you always to the end of the age." May God bless the reading of his word for his purposes. I now ask our speaker for today, Pao Tomakder, to give us God's message to us on the passage.
Good afternoon, everyone. Naririnig po ba ako?
Yes, Pao.
Okay.
Yes.
It's very interesting kasi as at this very moment, biglang naghang yung aking laptop. Buti na lang mayroon akong backup. So, before we begin, let's first pray. Let us pray. Panginoon, thank you po for this time that you have given us in order to hear your word. We ask, Lord, that you be with us and you guide us and you strengthen us as well, Lord, as we study itong napakagandang passage na ito. We pray, Lord, that your name be glorified this afternoon. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The year was 1963, and an evangelist named Sam Wolgemuth of the Youth for Christ International was in New Delhi, India, for an evangelistic meeting. Now, like other gospel rallies of that era, several people came, and Sam spoke passionately about salvation through Christ, using the famous John 3:16. And as he drew his message to a close with an invitation to repent and to believe, he was saddened to see only one boy coming forward to respond. To make matters worse, later that week, that boy, the only fruit of their gospel rally, attempted suicide by drinking poison. Nasa next slide yan. He felt so empty and lost that the only favorable way out, it seemed to him, was to end his life. But their family servant was quick to bring the dying youth to the hospital where he was revived and stabilized. When YFCI heard about this, they sent one of their directors, Fred David, to visit the young boy. I have a picture of Fred David in the next slide. He came with a little red Gideon's New Testament for that boy. And though he couldn't stay in the hospital that time, Fred instructed the teen's mother to read John 14 to him. Later, when she did, the frail lad was struck by Jesus' words in John 14, 19. Nakasulat doon, "Because I live, you also will live." And from that moment on, the boy dedicated his life to the pursuit of truth. And for 57 years, he toured more than 70 countries, preaching the gospel of Jesus, defending the faith, and touching millions of lives until the Lord took him home this year, no, May 2020. The boy's name is Ravi Zacharias. We know Ravi, but almost no one knew Fred David, who faithfully ministered to him, even through the simple act of giving a Bible and pointing him to John 14. We know Ravi, but almost no one knew Sam Wolgemuth, who continued preaching the gospel, even if only one boy responded to the invitation. Yes, it was God who ultimately saved Ravi, but we owe it to Sam and to Fred for being willing instruments to fulfill God's call to make disciples of all nations. And mind you, during that time, they didn't know that that lone response and that suicide survivor will one day be used mightily by God to preach Christ to the whole world. So I opened with this story because I want us to see the blessing of making disciples from God's vantage point. Sa mundo kasi natin ngayon, no? There are some things that our world now prizes. In the next slide, we can see that the return of investment is everything. So kung county lang yung yield ng isang outreach, konti yung response rate, we would dismiss it. Titigil na natin. In the world na mataas ang branding, pagpapahalaga sa PR, we set aside programs when they feel too Christian-y or Jesus-y. No? Or in a world that's all about sophistication, we reject the simple and the straightforward preaching of Christ. Sabihin pa ng iba, baduy, no? Or hindi uso. But today, we saw from the story of Dr. Ravi Zacharias, and we will see also from our passage that making disciples succeeds when it is done through the right authority, when it focuses on the main assignments, and is sustained by a powerful assurance. So this afternoon, as we continue our series para sa ating Missions Month, we turn to a very familiar passage. And I would even argue na after John 3:16, palagay ko, Matthew 28:18-20 or 16-20 ang isa sa pinaka-popular na verse, lalo na sa mga Christians. And today in the Great Commission, yung passage natin, I invite you to do three things. Ito rin yung outline natin. Number one, know Jesus' authority. Number two, obey Jesus' assignments. And number three, cling to Jesus' assurance. So let's just look at the setting of our passage. This is the reason why I added verses 16 to 17 para makita natin yung setting. Our passage closes the Gospel of Matthew. Yung passion, death, and resurrection ni Jesus, yung climax ng story ng salvation ay tapos na. No? Yung ultimate solution sa mission ng Panginoon to reconcile a fallen creation back to Him is done. And we see in verse 16, the 11 disciples, kasi wala na po si Judas by this time, they're in Galilee, they're in a mountain where Jesus directed them to go. And then in verse 17, there are two reactions. You will see the two reactions in the next slide. The first one, upon seeing Jesus, they worshiped Him. So if there's one verse na gusto nyong gamitin to show that Jesus is divine, this is a strong verse. No, kasi think about it. If you worship someone who is not God, that will be idolatry. Or if you accept worship but you are not God, that is blasphemy. No, but Jesus was worshipped and He accepted the worship. But interestingly, sabi din yan sa verse 17, no, some of them doubted. No, did they doubt? Meaning, hindi sila naniniwala kay Jesus? Now, most commentators note na yung doubt nila is not directed towards Jesus, but directed towards themselves. More of pinagdududahan nila yung senses nila. Tama ba itong nakikita ng mata ko? Hindi ba ako namamalik mata? Ito na ba talaga si Jesus? Ganong sense itong doubt na ito. Now, this is the setting where Jesus uttered His Great Commission. Yun yung tawag dito sa passage natin. It is great not only because the giver is great, but also because the scope is great. No, ang giver kasi is si Jesus at ang scope is the whole world. At kung napapatanong kayo, bakit siya commission? Bakit hindi siya mission? Now, the word mission is just a general term for fulfilling a task in a general sense. Pero yung commission, it has the idea of being sent in order to fulfill a mission. So, merong emphasis on the sending. So, if you ask me, we cannot deny the importance. We cannot deny the weight of this commission in relation to the other commands of Jesus. Kasi ito, sabi nga ng iba, kabilang sa kanyang last will and testament. Kabilang sa kanyang parting words. Kaya may bigat. Merong halaga. And for those who deny and those who downplay yung importance ng Great Commission, I would simply invite them to read through the New Testament at makikita nila dyan, no, that the books of Acts through Jude, they outline how the apostles fulfilled Jesus' Great Commission. So indeed, naintindihan ng mga apostles, naintindihan ng mga disciples na napakahalaga ng command. Kasi mula Acts, after the Gospel, hanggang Jude, before the fulfillment sa Revelation, they embraced it as their mission here on earth. So ngayon, let's dive into our passage at tignan natin anong matututunan natin about the Great Commission. Let's first go to our first point. Let us know Jesus' authority. Sino ang nagsisend sa atin? Who is commissioning us? Jesus is the one commissioning us. And what right does he have to commission us? Sabi sa verse 18, no, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. May dalawang sense yan. It's either all of heaven and all of earth's authority is given to Jesus. So yung cosmos, nagsasubmit kay Jesus. Or it could mean Jesus' authority can be found in heaven and on earth. So yung authority niya covers all of the cosmos. No? Yan yung two sense nung idea. But basically, they both point to Jesus having divine and ultimate authority. Ano ba yung word na authority? It means ultimate power of rule or government. That means Jesus has the power, has the will, has the command that must be submitted to and must be obeyed. So he is king of the universe, not just the universe, even beyond the universe, the physical and the metaphysical, the spiritual, heaven and on earth. And because of this, there are two implications. No, yung una, in fulfilling God's commands, we have nothing and no one to fear because Jesus is on our side. Now imagine nyo, the king of the universe is on your side. We can be at peace while making disciples because God is sovereign. He is in control. He is faithful. He is trustworthy. And second, because Jesus is king, this is not optional. The command to make disciples is not optional. God must be obeyed. Now, mapapatanong tayo, ay, parang medyo legalistic ata yung dating nun ah. But I want you to think about this. As Christians, let us remember that the gospel is a call to discipleship. It is a call to be a lifelong follower. The gospel is a call to submit to Christ, to die to self, to live for Jesus. But it is never under compulsion. And always out of love. Meron yan sa next slide. True followers of Christ joyfully take part in the Great Commission as the Lord opens opportunities because they so love Jesus that they cannot stop speaking about Him to others. Diba ito yung nung hinuli yung ilang disciples as inutusan sila, huwag na kayo mag-preach in the name of Jesus. Sabi na, hindi namin yan magagawa because we could not stop speaking about Jesus, yung aming na witness at yung aming na experience. So ganyan yung attitude ng isang believer. I think pinaka makaka-relate tayo again, no, kung meron kang favorite na anime, favorite na book or favorite na K-drama, 'di ba? You can't stop speaking about it kasi favorite mo siya, love na love mo siya. I hope ganun yung attitude natin towards Christ. Friends, knowing that Jesus has divine and ultimate authority, ang tanong dyan, how does this change your perspective on making disciples? I hope it dispels your fears and anxieties. I hope it awakens you mula sa pagiging passive, pagiging indifferent. I hope this gives you assurance, comfort, and strength. Whatever the effect, I pray that Jesus' authority will make you a joyful participant of the Great Commission. Ang hindi ko malimutan dito, nakasama ko lagi sa mga students from the time na nag-start ako, is si Kuya JV nyo. Kung naalala nyo si JV, isa siya siguro sa pinakamahiyain na estudyante na nakita ko or nakilala ko. Ang tahi-tahimik niya, di siya masyado nagsasalita. A man of few words, literally. Pero nung na-aral namin about the Great Commission at naintindihan niya na it's a command at it's a joy na nagpa-participate ang bawat Christian, nagulat ako kasi among sa mga active na students noon, no, ang in-expect ko na least na sumama sa evangelism ay siya. Pero it turned out, most of the evangelistic activities, yung mga one-on-one sharing, siya yung laging sumasama. No? Kahit sobrang mahiyain niya, medyo awkward pa siya pag mag-approach. Pero ganun na lang siguro yung desire niya to take part. Kaya he, by the grace of God, overcame yung pagiging mahiyain niya. At kung na-witness siya, parang nag-transform siya pag nag-share siya. Kasi yung man of few words, biglang, aba, ang daming in-explain tungkol sa gospel. Daming in-explain tungkol kay Jesus. At nakaka-encourage talaga. So yan po yung una, no? Let us know Jesus' authority. The second one, let us obey Jesus' assignments. At ito yung bulk ng ating message in verses 19 to 20. Now, what is the assignment? What is the main command? Alam natin, pag binasa natin yung 19 to 20, sabi ni Jesus dyan, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I have commanded you. If you ask, yourself, no, ano ba yung main command dito? Parang ang daming verbs eh. Go ba? Make disciples ba? Baptizing? Or teaching? No, makakatulong dyan if you go to the original language. At sa original, make disciples talaga yung merong emphasis as the main verb or the main command. Literally, this word means to disciple, to teach, to instruct people so that they will become followers of Jesus. So the Great Commission is an overall command to make disciples. Interestingly, no, itong word na ito carries the idea of gradual or progressive na process of learning towards maturity. So, yung paggawa ng disciple, mature disciple, is not an instant affair, no? Yung pagiging justified ng isang person, it happens instantaneously. The moment God grants grace that a person may believe and repent, nasisave siya at that very moment. Pero para mag-grow ang isang person into Christ-likeness, it will take time. Wala pong one day pa lang na Christian ay super mature na siya. No? It really takes time. And who or what is a disciple? Yung next slide, Sir Nico. Literally, a disciple is a learner or a student, a true follower of Jesus. So we are actually making disciples of Jesus Christ. So napakahalaga po niya na emphasis, no? We are making disciples of Jesus Christ, not our disciples. Kaya actually po ako, personal ko lang naman ito, I don't take offense sa iba, pero I rarely say na siya ay disciple ko, ito ay disciple ko. Kasi I always think na we are all disciples of Christ. So it's just a warning siguro, no? Let's be careful. Let's not claim na mga disipulo natin yan. We are all disciples of Jesus Christ. Now, the command is to make disciples. So napapatanong siguro tayo, no? So Kuya Pao, make disciples. Is it more of evangelism or is it more of discipleship? No, yan laging tanong. Is it more of evangelism or discipleship? Now, I want you to remember, yung command to make disciples is overarching. Ibig sabihin po, magkasama dyan sa command na yan, ang evangelism at discipleship as we know it today. Nung time na yun, wala kasing ganong division. No? Evangelism is the proclamation of the good news of Jesus, that Jesus lived and died and rose again for the forgiveness of our sins. And it's usually sa mga unbelievers. Yung discipleship naman, as we know it today, involves teaching, mentoring, training people towards maturity. and Christ-likeness. No? Towards believers yan most of the time. Pero yung pag kinumbine mong pareho, yun po yung disciple-making. That's what Jesus is trying to tell them. No? Not just evangelism, not just discipleship. At we start the disciple-making process the moment we intentionally reach out to unbelievers and continue on until their maturity. Kaya po, we cannot just emphasize one over the other. In fact, ito pong division na ito na evangelism and discipleship, it's a modern invention. During that time, hindi ganon yung view nila. When they say, make disciples, magkakonect yung dalawang yan. I think, no, the attitude of trying to divide the two comes from either, number one, in the next slide, either we are unwilling to commit dun sa long journey of growing towards Christian maturity. No, napaka matrabaho kasi yan. If we commit to follow up and walk alongside a person sa isang lifelong probably na discipleship, napaka matrabaho. So sometimes we just emphasize yung mas mabilis na pag-proclaim ng gospel. Ah, basta ako na lang mag-share. Tapos pag naging Christian na, ipapasa ko na lang sa discipleship ministry. No, that should not be the attitude. Or pwede rin naman, on the other extreme, meron tayong fear of rejection or fear of uncertainty. Kasi hard work din yung you go to hostile people, hostile places, tapos mag-share ka, no? Baka pagtawanan ka pa o kaya ikaw ay mapahamak. So people would emphasize na lang na ako na lang yung magti-teach, ako na lang yung magbi-build up ng mga believers na antay ko na lang kung sino yung dadalhin nung evangelism committee. Now, sana hindi rin gano'n yung attitude. I think what I'm just trying to say is we should always be ready. Whether God opens the opportunity to evangelize or disciple. Hindi sana yung meron ka ng kausap, no? Tatanungin ka, oh, Kuya Pao, ano bang ibig sabihin nitong gospel? Ah, sa discipleship committee kasi ako eh. Balik ka na lang pag Christian ka. No? Sana hindi ganun yung attitude. Kundi yung attitude, kung yun na yung moment na binigay ni Lord, kahit kinakaban ka or natatakot, sige, share what you know. Share your testimony. Kung yun lang yung kaya mong i-share, the Lord will use that. Because making disciples is part of, if not the mission of the church. So kasama kasi yan sa parting command ng Panginoon. So sana, let us not downplay it and let's put them together, evangelism and discipleship. So how do we fulfill the assignment? Ito na po yung tanong. How do we make disciples? Let's remember the three participles na natira. Let us go, let us baptize, let us teach people to obey. Now, these three participles, they are anchored on the main verb, which is to make disciples. Let's look at them one by one. The first one is go. Originally, sa Greek, yung literal niyan is as you go or having gone. Now, ang implication, as you continue to live your life, as you move around from one destination to another, you should make disciples. So meron siyang emphasis ng intentionality. We do not wait for people to come, but we are called to go where the people are, to reach out to people sa ating immediate spheres or even beyond our spheres, to find those who are open to the gospel. Now, another proof na merong emphasis sa intentionality is pag tinignan natin yung original na grammatical relationship nitong go sa main verb, interesting siya actually. Kasi yung go, it is not rendered going or as you go kasi yung main verb na make disciples, it actually lends its weight doon sa go. That's why it's go and make disciples. In a sense, para siyang main verb din. Medyo mas mabigat siya kaysa doon sa dalawang ibang participles. Kaya meron ding emphasis on being active, no? Being more urgent. So we need to go and to make disciples. Now, I think nasa next slide dyan, Sir Nico. And there are two implications dito. No? Before that pala, we make disciples, hindi lamang sa kung nasaan tayo, kundi even beyond. No? Kasi sabi dyan, make disciples of all nations. So, people groups, cross-cultural missions ay kasama dyan. So, ang dalawang implication niyan, no, yung una, We need to intentionally start disciple making kung nasaan tayo, no? Where we are now. Kung student ka sa school, kung dormer ka sa dorm, kung teacher ka sa classroom, kung professor, kung professional ka sa workplace. Kung nasa bahay ka lang, sa mga kasama mo sa bahay. So make disciples where you are now. At kanina yung sinabi ko nga, may intentionality rin to go beyond yung sphere ng influence natin. Kung tinawag tayong to go and make disciples beyond the Philippines, I hope meron tayong willingness to obey. Or kung hindi man, to people na hindi Filipino, para sa FIS halimbawa, I hope we have willingness to obey. Now, how do we go? No. You can think of this on a personal level or on a corporate level. Now, how can we intentionally start going to make disciples? Siguro on a personal note, you are always aware na yung sinasabi mo, yung mga tinatanong mo, yung mga kinakausap mo, opportunity yan to start making disciples. So you can talk to your friends, your family, your peers, your neighbors mo, at meron ka laging intentionality na as the Lord opens, you will include Christ in the conversation. Or on a personal level, pag may nakita ka na missions trip, why not join? Pero ngayon, mahirap dahil may COVID. So why not pray for the unreached people groups? Or kung may opportunity na mag-lead ka ng mga Bible studies, why not volunteer on a personal level? No, marami ngayon, no? Nagpa-plug ako lagi. Nandiyan yung mga freshmen. Why not be a discipler for this freshman? Or we can think of this as a corporate activity. Napakalakas ng emphasis kanina sa Tagalog ni Kuya Jess na it is a corporate activity. It is good that we're moving on a personal level sa pag-go at pag-make disciples, but we should not also forget that this is a mission of the church as a whole. So we could think about a comprehensive outreach plan, for example, sa new normal natin. Anong gagawin natin? Magkakaroon ba tayo ng online EBS? Magkakaroon ba tayo ng social media outreach? I think this was the thrust of Pastor Min Ho Song dati. That's why he encouraged the entire church na magkaroon ng discovery meetings. Kasi gusto niya, desire niya, that the church as a whole will work together in reaching people who don't know Jesus yet. So yan po yung goal, no? Intentionality, where we are now, and also intentionality in going beyond to make disciples. The second one is to baptize. No, baptize them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Napakahalaga po na singular yung name dyan, no? Kasi it points to our Trinitarian God. Isang name ng ating God, one God in three persons, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What is baptism? Yung ritual po na nakasanayan natin is the immersion sa tubig. At ang meaning niyan is identification of a person with Christ and his people. No, yun po ibig sabihin. Kapag ang isang person ay nagpabaptize, hindi po ito prerequisite para ma-save ang isang tao, no. In fact, kapag ikaw ay nagpabaptize, Christian ka na. Ang malimit nga na explanation, what is baptism? It's an outward expression of an inward change. In the next slide, you're expressing outwardly kung ano yung katotohanan ng nangyari sa loob mo. Now, there's a hidden implication sa component na ito ng disciple making. Now, I hope you follow yung logic now. To be identified with Jesus means that the person is already saved or born again. No, hindi ka ma-identify kung hindi ka pa naman saved talaga. A person can be born again only if he or she believes or trusts in Jesus, repents of sin. And a person can only believe or trust the good news if he or she hears it, understands it, and believes it. Now, ito ngayon nakalagay sa screen natin in Romans 10, 14 to 15. No? How can they believe if no one will, if they have never heard? How can they hear if they... no one will preach to them. How can they preach if no one sends them? No, walang magsisend sa mga magpipreach. Therefore, to baptize in the name of our triune God implies evangelism leading to a person's salvation. No, because one cannot be baptized na unbeliever. So ang tanong, kung ganun pala, bakit ang ginamit ni Matthew is baptize? Hindi niya sinabi evangelize. No? Why baptize, not evangelize? You have to remember in their context, no? Evangelism, salvation, baptism, closely knit yan. Hindi mo yan mapaghiwa-hiwalay. It's a given during the time that when one hears and believes, he or she immediately gets baptized. You remember Ethiopian eunuch? No, sinesheran siya. Nakakita sila ng puddle. Sabi niya, oh to, may water. Bakit? Anong nag-stop sa akin para mabaptize? No? At si Mark din, dun sa kanyang version ng Great Commission, sabi niya, those who believe and are baptized, magkakonect sa kanila talaga. You will not see unbaptized believers in that context. No? Sa atin ngayon, yung association hindi ganun kalakas. But during that time, the association is easily seen, lalo na mga first century believers. Pag sinabi mong baptism, gets nila merong evangelism at merong salvation. Sa time natin, I guess, no, I think, mas malakas pa yung association nung pray to receive. No? Minsan napagkoconnect natin yan, iisip natin required na mag-pray to receive para yung person ay hindi tapos yung salvation story kapag hindi siya nag-pray to receive. Parang ganun, no, yung association, I guess. No, pero yung pray to receive and yung baptism, hindi sila required for salvation. Pero nakoconnect kasi natin ng malakas. So yun yung idea. No, that's why yung baptism yung ginamit pero implied would be evangelism. Now, how do we baptize? How do we evangelize? No, yung going, baptizing, associated yan sa evangelism, outreach, mission sa context natin. And there's no other way but to witness and also to evangelize. Now, historically, ang difference nito is when you witness, you live out the gospel. Ito yung pinapamuhay mo, nakikita sa action mo yung gospel. When you evangelize, that's the moment you proclaim the gospel. Pero lagi-lagi dapat, no, you have to witness and evangelize. Hindi pwedeng witness lang. Hindi mo in-explain kung anong ginagawa mo. No? Pag nag-evangelize ka, words lang, pinoclaim mo, I would say okay yon. However, dapat makita rin sa buhay mo na kung ano yung pinoproclaim mo ay totoo. No, ang na-imagine ko lagi yan si Kuya Arvin nung meron siyang roommate, no? Tapos in-observe siya lagi ng roommate niya na nagko-quiet time, nag-church, nag-DCF, no? Tapos akala nung roommate niya nung una, yun yung way para ikaw ay lumapit kay God, no? Ikaw ay magbasa ng Bible para ma-save ka, mag-church para ma-save ka. Not until tinanong niya si Kuya Arvin, Kuya Arvin, Arvin, bakit mo pa ito ginagawa? No? Bakit napaka-consistent mo dyan sa mga religious na activities mo? Doon nagkaroon opportunity si Kuya Arvin to explain that you need to put your faith in Christ at result niyan is ito. You grow in reading the Bible, you grow in fellowship and going to church, etc. Yan. So we need to always witness and evangelize. Hindi pwedeng wala yung evangelize. There should be proclamation. Pag nagpo-proclaim ka naman, dapat nakikita sa life mo. There's one experience sa akin, hindi ko malilimutan yan, kung saan yung witness pwedeng may effects sa evangelism. Meron noon isang beach missions. No? Meron akong shineran na matandang babae. Sabi niya sa akin, alam mo, wala naman akong problema dyan sa sinishare mo eh. Naniniwala naman ako na mabuti talaga yung sinishare mo. Pero alam mo, ang hindi ko matanggap, kasi kayong mga born again, sabi niya talaga, kayong mga born again, yung kapatid ko kasi nung naging born again, aba, bigla naman nang yung ugali pumangit. Sabi niya, aba, ako naman napaisip. Paano naman papangit ang ugali kung naging true follower ni Christ? Pero yun ang effect, no? Dahil nga akala niya pag naging born again ka or naging Christian ka, papangit yung ugali mo. Ayaw niya maniwala sa kung ano yung pinoproclaim ko. So sinabi ko na lang, eh baka po hindi totoong naniniwala yung anak o yung kapatid pala. Kasi po sa Bible sabi, pag ikaw naging Christian, mababago ka for the better. So remember those two things. Now, if we're evangelizing, helping people to get to know Jesus, we can think of the audience. No? Sa next slide dyan, Sir Nico. We can think of our audience. No? Pwedeng stranger. Yeah. So, direct yan. No? Pero ngayon, hindi pwedeng masyado sa labas, may COVID. So, pwedeng online. A good idea ng isang teacher ko ngayon sa school, sabi niya, you can transform your online Bible studies mag-decide kayo one or two meetings ng year na yon, i-allot nyo na mag-invite ng hindi pa believer at gawin nyo yung meeting na yun na evangelistic. Pwede daw ganon, na pinaplan ko yun na gawin. So stranger. Pwede rin naman close yung relationship mo. Napansin ko pag close relationship, malakas yung emphasis or malakas yung opportunity for follow-up. No? Hindi ko malilimutan lagi dyan, example ni Sir Nico. No? Kasi yung kanya mga kaibigan noon sa Youth for Christ na nakakasama pa rin niya, so nag-start sila ng Bible study. At dahil kaibigan niya, no? Willing sila at open na mag-ulit-ulit at magtuloy-tuloy sa pag-aaral. And also, kung isipin natin yung mga kapamilya natin. Again, Sir Nico with his lola and yung kanyang parents din. No? Yan yung blessing ng close relationship. Malakas yung follow-up. Yung stranger naman, pwede kang mag-sow ng seeds kahit sa mga hindi mo kakilala. So we can actually, no, ngayong time na to, think of people. Sino ba yung mga hindi ko na nakakausap? No? Pwede ko sigurong kamustahin and hopefully may opportunity to share the gospel. Or kung nasa bahay ka lang din naman, but di mo kausapin yung mga housemate mo and then help them, no, to know Jesus or grow more in their walk in Christ. We can also think of tools. No? Isang ano yan, how can we share the gospel? You can think of tools. Usually yan, may gospel summary. Ito yung mga mini-memorize, no? Mga Evan tools. No? Romans 6.23, yung bridge illustration, Evan bracelet, no? Or yung plan ko nga ganun, gagawa ko ng video ng Romans 6.23, ishishare ko, and then tatanungin ko lang, ano yung feedback nyo sa video? So pwedeng ganyan, gospel summaries. Pwede rin expanded presentation. What do I mean? Para to sa mga mas spontaneous na mga tao, na they can sustain a conversation, halimbawa. Or they want a longer Bible study, no, kagaya nung EBS ni Pastor Bell, Encounters with Jesus. Basically, ang point lang naman, it's not really on the audience or the tool, but the heart that is willing to go and proclaim Christ. No, ano man yung opportunity, ano man yung means na ibigay ng Panginoon. And when we talk about proclaiming Christ, ang tanong dyan, ano ba ang role ko? At ano ba ang role ng Panginoon sa evangelism? Man's side sa evangelism begins with an intentional move to help people know about Jesus through their acts, their deeds, or their life. At mag-culminate yan sa proclamation ng gospel message at sa pag-challenge sa mga tao na mag-respond. Sa side ni God, God alone can give new heart, can change people's heart, the grace to help people to believe and repent. Man will preach the gospel, but God alone can give the results. In fact, si God lang din yung magbibigay sa atin ng desire para mag-share ng gospel. So we proclaim, but God alone gives new birth. At the end of the day, now we can really just say, we are saved by grace alone, through faith alone, in Christ alone, for the glory of God alone. So yan po yung baptize. The third one, we teach them to obey. No? Teach to obey everything that Jesus commanded. Important na i-emphasize, hindi lamang yung teach, but teach to obey. Kasi po, pag teach lang, may idea na nag-impart ka lang ng knowledge. No? Walang application. Pero kung teach to obey, no, may view na you impart knowledge so that it will be applied. Ito po usually yung dilemma ko. Kasi I am fascinated with facts and information about God. Pero, yung important thing really is that we become fascinated not just with information about God, but by God Himself. No? Napakahalaga po yun. We will be fascinated by God Himself. Sabi nga ni James, sa next slide, James 1:22, we must be doers of the word, hindi lang hearers. Kasi if we're just hearers, we may be deceiving ourselves. Hindi pala tayo tunay na Kristiyano. What are we to teach and to obey? Sabi dyan, every command that Jesus has given, every command of God from His word, no, we are to teach believers to love, to live God's word. The whole counsel of God, yan, makita mamaya sa Acts 20-27, at kasama din ang Great Commission. Sa next slide, tignan nyo yung sinabi, no? I do not shrink from declaring to you the whole counsel of God. Pay careful attention to yourselves and to all the flock in which the Holy Spirit has made you overseer to care for the church of God. Napakalaga ng whole counsel of God, yung buong Bible, Genesis to Revelation. Alam niyo yung irony niyan sa mga missionaries who go sa mga tribes. Yung mga tribes mas aral kaysa sa atin pagdating sa Bible. Kasi the way they teach or the way they evangelize, nag-start sila sa Genesis. No? Creation, fall, tapos yung story ni Abraham, Noah muna, Abraham, down sa kings, sa pagka-exile nila, hanggang umabot kay Jesus Christ, hanggang sa Revelation. No, ganun sila magturo. Kaya ironically, mas aral yung mga nasa tribes kaysa sa atin. Pero let's make it a point sana, no? Na we learn also the whole counsel of God. Genesis down to Revelation. How do we teach to obey? Sa ngayon, teaching to obey is associated with discipleship. No? There's no other way but to instruct and also to model. No? Instruct about the commands of Christ and to model Christ-likeness in our lives. Now, pwedeng you can think of this as a formal thing. No? One-on-one na Bible study, small group, no? Classroom na Bible study. Or pwede naman spontaneous or creative ka. No, friendly chat. No, meron akong dormmate dati na ang hindi pupunta ng fellowship eh, pero Christian background. The only time na nakikita ko siya is kapag nagtututbrush kami sa CR. So yun lang yung time. Kakamustahin ko siya. Oh, kamusta? Nag-church ka ba ngayon? Kamusta? Nag-Bible study ka ba? Yun. So, spontaneous eh. Yun lang yung time. Pwede ni namang through your modeling sa life mo. Napakalaga ito para sa mga parents, no? Model it to your children. Kayo talaga yung unang disciples nila eh. Yan yung aking encouragement. The parents are the first disciples of the children. So, ipakita sa buhay natin. Meron dating isang student din sa Philippine Science. Napakamahiyain niya. Leader siya, no? Sa Acts. Doon sa ushering team. Sobrang mahiyain niya pag siya ay nag-disciple or nagtuturo, ang style niya lagi, sasabihin niya doon sa mga bago sa ushering team, observe niyo na lang kung anong ginagawa ko. Tapos yun na, i-observe nila kung anong ginagawa niya. And it works, no? Kasi yung mga kasama niya na mahiyain din dahil nga ayaw nila nag-uusap, di ba? Observe na lang and then they're able to serve sa ushering team. There's also an implication when it comes to teaching. Merong prerequisite dyan. You have to learn, you also have to study, you have to meditate on God's word yourself para ikaw ay makapagturo. Makinig sa mga sermon, sa iyong quiet time, magbasa ng mga discipleship books, etc. So learning doesn't end. It doesn't mean that you need to master everything para ikaw ay makapagturo. Ang most important dyan, you have the right heart and you have the right attitude. No? Alam nyo sa experience ko po, minsan, alam ko lang is one lesson ahead lang ako sa estudyante. Chapter 2 ako, chapter 1 pa lang siya. Pag nagtuturo ka na, the Holy Spirit will give you mga insights and ideas na hindi mo naisip na nagpre-prepare ka. Kaya mas na-enrich yung inyong Bible study. No? Now, is it only about facts? Is it only about information? Sabi ko kanina, hindi. Kasama po dito sa teaching is you have to build relationship in the next slide. You have to ask God to make you genuinely concerned para sa mga tao na kasama mo sa Bible study or tinuturuan mo. You have to share life with them. Kagaya ni Jesus na nag-incarnate sa mundo. Napakahirap po yan. Yan yung aspect na nahirapan ako. No, how to deepen relationship. Minsan kasi madali lang magturo eh. Pero how to be concerned with other people? You have to ask God to help you. You have to model. Yung pangalawa. Sabi ko kanina, no? Help natin yung mga students, yung mga kasama sa Bible study, if they see us doing kung ano yung ating pinipreach. We live out the Christ-like lives. Pangatlo, we can also share the vision. No? Vision of God. No? Ibig sabihin, we help yung mga kasama natin to see the bigger picture. The advancement of God's kingdom. Not yung individual na mga empires natin or church, kundi yung glory ng Panginoon above all. So we have to keep sharing this vision of the glory of Christ. Ako ngayon, when I start a Bible study, ang una ko para ma-encourage yung bata is to share them ano ba yung end goal na gusto naming ma-achieve. We want to learn so that we will grow and one day we will help others learn truths about God and Jesus, the gospel and the scripture as well. So para makita nung bata na hindi lamang ito matututo ako na matututo, kundi one day, as the Lord gives the opportunity, makapag-share din ako sa ibang tao. Alam ko enjoyable na dun sa Bible study, yung mga kasama mo, kilala mo, at for a very long time, magkakasama kayo. Pero sana, no, let's be careful na hindi tayo maging exclusive na circle. Kasi bahagi nga nung command sa atin ng Panginoon is to make disciples, hindi lamang sa spheres natin, kundi even beyond our spheres. So I guess, dapat no, natural na magkaroon tayo ng desire na may mga tao din na maturuan tayo or makakilala sa Panginoon sa pamamagitan natin. So yun po, yung pangatlo. Pang-apat, let us be accountable. It helps to build accountability. Encourage the students or the people to make personal goals sa kanilang spiritual lives and outreach and magkamustahan tayo sa isa't isa. Hindi naman dapat sobrang strict na may checklist pa, ginawa mo ba to, ito hindi, no? Baka kasi masobrahan. Pero parang genuine lang na pangamusta. How are you? How's your week? Etc. Mafe-feel yan ng estudyante kung genuine or hindi. At panlima, challenge them, no? Encourage them to also apply what they are learning, to share their lessons, to live out God's word. No? Challenge yourselves to go beyond your comfort zones. No, madalas, yung naririnig ko, no, lalo na sa student ministry, ang fear yung generation gap. No, baka hindi ako makarelate, di sila makarelate sa akin. Totoo yun, no? Minsan ang hirap. Minsan kailangan mong alamin ano ba yung anime na pinag-uusapan nila, ano ba yung games na sinasabi nila. I-research mo na ano ba ibig sabihin ng mga ginagamit na nila na terms. No? Minsan hindi ko na rin alam, kailangan ko nang i-google. No? Pero we need to surrender this to the Lord. No? Kung ang Lord naman ang in charge, kahit itong gap na to, He can make us, help us overcome this barrier. No, after all, yung mga young people, they need the wisdom of the mature. At si Paul din, kung isipin nyo, hindi naman bata si Paul when he discipled Timothy or Titus or yung iba pang mga kasama niya sa Bible studies. Many years, but it is really God who helped him do this. At panghuli, give opportunities of service. Let those in your Bible studies serve, no? Help them lead. Help them lead others who are younger than them sa discipleship groups, no? Peers nila. No? Maaring mag-fail sila, magkaroon sila ng mga mistake, pero bahagi yun ng growing. Kung naalala nyo si Jesus, no? Sa mga apostles niya, ilang beses din nagkamali yung mga apostle, minsan mafe-feel mo yung frustration din ni Jesus sa kanila, pero patuloy pa din. No? Tinuturuan niya sila at ginaguide at nililid. Not until the Holy Spirit empowered them that they were really able to fulfill yung mission, commission ng Panginoon. And this is what we want to see sa ating mga kasama sa discipleship group. We want to see them growing into maturity in Christ. And by God's grace, we want to see Christ disciples who also desire to make Christ disciples, who also desire to make Christ disciples. Parang 2 Timothy 2:2. Yeah, famous ito. Yung sabi ni Paul, no? What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, entrust to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. No, hindi tayo nagpipiramiding, no? Ang point lang dito, meron po tayong desire na magkaroon ng heart to multiply, no? Yung mga people na tinuturuan natin. Turuan din natin na kung magbukas ang Lord ng opportunity, grab it, no? And teach others as well, who are able to teach others as well. Yan. At ang ultimate goal po natin, not numbers, but to bring glory to God. No? Yun ang ultimate goal natin. Kasi kung isipin mo, no, it is God alone who has the power to save people. At alam niya kung gaano karami ang mga yan na masisave. So hindi niya issue yung bilang. Ang issue niya, mga tao talaga ay mag-submit at magkaroon ng genuine relationship sa kanya. So to summarize itong tatlong how, sa next slide, we make disciples, next slide, Pastor Nico, We make disciples by being intentional in our current spheres of influence and beyond to make Jesus known in our whole of life, words, deeds, so that people will trust in Jesus as Savior and Lord, and they will move from life to death. Yan yung truth na nasa baptism. And teaching all true believers to live out Jesus' commands for God's glory and the expansion of His kingdom. Yan po yung tatlo. No? Make disciples, go, baptize, evangelize, teach, teach to obey. And lastly, dun sa ating tatlong bagay, we have to cling to Jesus' assurance. Nasa verse 20, B tayo. Alam po ni Jesus, this is not an easy task, especially in a world that is hostile to the gospel. But we are not alone sa pag-fulfill ng Great Commission. We don't rely on our own strength or our own power. Sabi nga ni Jesus, no, and behold, I will be with you always until the very end of the age. Kasama natin si Jesus. We rely on Him. Yung word na behold dyan, no, it's an interjection. Merong emphasis. Always, sabi din niya, all the days until the completion of the age, hanggang sa second coming niya. This is a continuing ministry with a continuing support from the one true cosmic authority, at that is Jesus Christ. So friends, minsan nadi-discourage tayo kasi few people or unresponsive yung mga people, but let us find comfort in Christ. Minsan naman, napakadaming tao. Ang danger, maging proud tayo. No, ang galing ko. No. No. Let us draw humility from Christ. Tandaan natin, it's really all because of Christ. There is a call for us to live in full trust, assurance, na si Jesus in control yan. In control siya. And all the outreach that we do, He's giving us the power to share. He's opening doors for the gospel. He's calling people to respond, comforting us kapag discouraged tayo. He's lifting our spirits na huwag tayong mag-give up and joyfully and faithfully minister sa pag dito sa mundong ito, in this fallen world. Si Ravi Zacharias, no, one of his last words daw when he was dying, was reminding his family, never give up. Never give up, sabi niya, because Christ is with them. Sa akin naman, no, maniwala kahit hindi, sobrang takot ako nun mag-evangelize. Ayaw ko talaga mag-evangelize. Kaya namimigil ako ng tracks, tapos nag-progress, nakipag-usap na ako, and then by the grace of God, naging more or less natural siya. No? At what helped me really is I keep thinking and I keep praying when I go and share Christ. Ang prayer ko sa Panginoon, Panginoon, please, would you lead me to the person that you have prepared sa araw na ito na makinig at tumanggap at maniwala at mag-repent sa kanyang kasalanan. So when I go and share, ang attitude ko lang, I'm looking for that person. Kung si person na ito ayaw, hindi pa siya yon, hindi pa ito yung person. Yung next, kung ayaw, so parang hinahanap ko lang. And then, pag ito na yung person, praise God, the Lord has drawn me to this person. Pag may next pa, praise God. So yun lang yung attitude ko. I'm looking for that person whom God has prepared to hear His word. At magugulat kayo, no? Lagi-lagi, yung person na yun talaga na prepare ni God, perfect timing talaga. Hindi siya accident. You really have to be there at that very moment, at that very place para kausapin yung person na yun. In conclusion, sa last moments ni Jesus sa mundo, nakita natin, He sent forth His disciples. Sabi niya, make disciples. Hindi lang yan yung 11, no, kundi lahat. Kasi pag tinignan mo yung Acts, lahat ng Christians ginawa yan. Go, be intentional in reaching out where you are and also beyond. Baptize, closely related to sharing the gospel as a lifestyle. Words, deeds, the whole of life. Para yung mga tao maniwala, mag-repent, at they will declare their allegiance to Christ. Yan yung idea ng baptism. Teach to obey, not just impart information, but encourage application. I think, as the next slide, para sa mga nasa DCF, familiar sila dito. No? Diyan po nanggaling yan. No? Kapag inisip mo yung make disciples, plinat lang namin na bilog. No? Yung go, baptize, teach to, obey. Kaya nagkaroon ng seek, share, strengthen, and send. It's our humble attempt to try to make people always remember yung tatlong bagay na yon, yung 4S na yan, seek, share, strengthen, and send. Make disciples by going, baptizing, teaching people to obey. Yan. So yan yung idea niyan. It's not my invention, it's just an attempt na i-put yan into naalalang illustration. And all, you depend on prayer, you use the scripture, and it's a community activity. And so, so we can do all these assignments, no? Sa next slide, because we have Jesus as our authority and our assurance. Itong tatlong assignments na to, we can only do by the authority of Jesus and the assurance that He gives. So balikan natin, no? Si Sam Wolgemuth, many years after, sakala niya nalaman na yung isang boy na yon na nag-receive, na na-discourage pa siya, is now being used by God mightily to preach the gospel. So na-rebuke siya. So every time na mag-preach si Ravi dun sa area niya, he will really clear his schedule. Pupunta siya at dun siya sa harap, talagang front row, at kitang-kita siya na laging very excited, grateful. No? Isa to sa mga blessing ng Panginoon sa aking ministry. Tapos si Fred David, yan. Yung picture po na yan, yung naka-square si Fred David. Yung pong pogi na matangkad, yan po si Ravi Zacharias. Yes, yung may arrow. Yan. Si Fred David naman, in his dying days, I think 2000 to 2003, yung mga last conversations nila ni Ravi, sabi niya, very thankful daw siya sa Panginoon kasi sa dami ng mission na pwedeng ibigay ni God sa kanya, binigay ni God yung isang mission, which is to give that Red Gideon's Bible kay Ravi Zacharias. At dahil doon, nakakilala si Lord by His grace, nakakilala si Ravi by the grace of the Lord sa Panginoon. So it's really very wonderful, no, yung kwentong ito. When we enter God's presence, no, we'll be greeted by all the people na we barely remember, at pinapasalamatan tayo because one time, inalaw natin ng Lord na gamitin tayo para mag-share ng gospel sa kanila. So naging bahagi tayo nung link, ito yung link, links in a chain, nung kanilang kwento para makakilala. Isang, lagi ko itong kinikwento nga, isa sa mga for sure papasalamatan ko pag nasa heaven na may isang lola talaga nung ako ay elementary pa na nakasabay ko sa tricycle. Binigyan niya ako ng track. Binasa ko yung track. For some reason, naalala ko din naman yung track. It's about salvation and about punishment of hell. May emphasis ng hell na. True naman yung nakalagay doon. Pero ngayon, hindi ko na maalala yung itsura ni Lola. Hindi ko alam yung pangalan niya. Hindi ko alam kung nasa na siya, kung buhay pa. Pero I thank God for her because she allowed herself to be used by God para maging part ng links in the chain ng aking faith story. So napaka-wonderful siguro yun, no? Na one day, when we face our Master and Lord, no, sasabi niya, well done, my good and faithful servant. At hindi lang yun, no? Pagkatapos nun, ang dami mga tao din na upapasalamat because we partnered with God in sharing the gospel, making disciples. So yun po yung aking encouragement. I pray that we will all have that heart and desire to also make disciples. Not by our own strength, but by the strength of Christ, by going, baptizing, sharing, and teaching to obey. Let us pray. Panginoon, thank you po for the opportunity to share. Thank you, Lord, kahit na may mga technical difficulties, you really make a way. At alam namin nga, Lord, gusto mo itong marinig kasi the fact na yung kaaway gumagawa ng kung ano-ano, ayaw niyang marinig namin itong message na ito. But Lord, you are sovereign. And so we thank you. We pray, Lord, na during this time, kahit pandemic, you open doors for us. Thank you for technologies. Kaya nakaka-share pa rin kami, nakaka-minister kahit online lang. May you grant us, Lord, the heart more than fear and anxiety, may we have joy to also take part, Lord, in this wonderful, great commission. At gawin sana namin itong everyday commission. Salamat po ulit, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.